Thank you, Les Bushman, for having me here tonight. It is an honor. You could be among these mighty people. I hope I'm going to live up to the expectations. We heard about Africa. We heard about Jamaica. We heard about New York. And now we are going to hear about Zanzibar. And the theme of my address to you tonight is rethinking the governance of the total island. If Marcus Garvey would come back and see the state of this little island, he would know at first contact that something is wrong with its people. He said that, and I quote, "History is the landmark by which we are directed into the full course of life. The history of a movement, the history of a nation, the history of a race is the guidepost of that movement's destiny, that nation's destiny, that race's destiny," unquote. Since I intend to consider the destiny of the island of St. Martin, I must inevitably allow myself to be guided by the history of our island. Because our leaders have taken this island away from its history, because our leaders have turned their backs to each other for the last 50 to 60 years, because our leaders have no consideration for the history of this island, we are going against the wall, in spite of the incredible potentials of the little jewel we have been entrusted to care about and to preserve. What is the state of our nation today? Let us start with the North, or the French side. The North is dying, and it will take divine intervention to save it. However, for the colonial rulers and elected representatives, everything is fine in the best of words. The state of the North administration does not exist in the books. We are beyond higher supervision. If we were a company or a business, we would have to file for bankruptcy. In order to apply their destructive policies, laws are trampled upon, human rights are violated, foreigners have more rights than nationals, but no duties. Values of survival have become values of destruction. Work has lost its ethical value of social promotion and individual progress. The people are crying out, most of them in silence. Fear has taken hold of our citizens. Ordinary words like autonomy and democracy are meaningless. Everything is done to conform with the secret destructive agenda. In the midst of the technological age, policies of the 17th and 18th centuries are applied, which we thought were of the past. In the North, we are living a form of full-fledged colonialism, a system which has destroyed the very fabric of our society, the very core of our beings, the very purpose of our tourist economy, in the span of 30 years, which according to the experts is a time span needed for a colonial power to take over. After 10 extra years of preparation, putting in place the elected representative that will not object to this system by means of so-called democratic practices. In the South, we are also heading to a dead end if we do not redress the course of our practices. The responsibility lies in the hands of the most advanced and autonomous entity. There is a parliament on the island. The role of parliamentarians is to make laws to ensure the good functioning and survival of the nation. And whether we like it or not, we shall sink together, or we shall rise together. The island is one. The people or nation is one. We sing it, we talk about it in our official speeches and informal addresses, but do we really mean it? On both sides of the island, the same cries of the people are heard. Who pays heed to these cries? We are losing the soul of our nation. We can no longer pay lip service to the people or nation, to the resources, and to the uniqueness of this island. It is the smallest binational island in the world, 37 square miles. The solution of our problems can be found nowhere else on this planet but in our history. Our ignorance of who we are, the uniqueness of our little world, is a source of exploitation of our economy and of depletion of our human and natural resources for any outsider coming to our shores. Wake up, people. Rise, your mighty race, would Marcus Garvey tell us. He would also add, and I quote, take away industry from a race. He means here the habit of working hard and steadily. Take away political freedom from a race, and you have a group of slaves. Another quote. Before you have a government, you must have the people. Without the people, there can be no government. The government must be, therefore, an expression of the will of the people. End of quote. Another one that a lot of us quote sometimes. A people without the knowledge of their past, origin, and culture is like a tree without roots. I will repeat, under the guidance of this great mind of the past century, and paraphrase his quote by saying, the history of this island is the landmark, the guidepost of that island's destiny. So allow me to elaborate on the destiny of this island and to refer to the historical document that has been the guidepost of life on our island for about 300 years, when each side was separately integrated into their French and Dutch regional centers. I'm speaking of the Constitutive Agreement that brought this island into existence, the 1648 Agreement of Peaceful Cohabitation, and not, as our European leaders say today, of cooperation. It was not. It was a treaty, an agreement of peaceful cohabitation. The constitutional separation of the last 50 to 60 years did not work in the interest of either side of the island. Therefore, this dissatisfaction gave rise to an overseas collectivity on the 15th of July 2007, what we have now in the north, and to Country St. Martin on 10-10-10. These are statuses detaching both sides from their regional centers, but bringing them closer to their European anchors, who comfortably started to put in place their cooperation for the island in matters of defense, joint police activities, drug circulation, money laundering, criminal arrest, etc. You all know it, which are necessary. But what about the daily cohabitation on the island? Who is taking care of that? I'm quite sure we are realizing today that these new constitutional developments are not working for many areas of this cohabitation. Because cohabitation is not the competence of the Dutch or the French, although European nationals are benefiting from numerous opportunities on account of our open border. Actually, we need a joint government body to take care of the common issues of the total island. In both constitutional cases, the 1648 Agreement of Cohabitation have been totally violated in its essential aspects. Our island, the Siamese twins, have been separated, and one of them is truly dying. The other is experiencing basic survival challenges. It is more than time that the people of the total island rethink the type of governance necessary to save the people and the total island. For 300 years, the people of this island were able to overcome vital difficulties by disrupting the plantation economy, owning land, and creating their own society and means of subsistence. The same reliance with resilience is expected to be. The same courage is expected today. Let not the sacrifice of Officer Benjamin's life be in vain. The settlements of the last 60 years have created new situations. And when I use the word settlements to say people who have come to settle in our land. So the settlements of the last 60 years have created new situations which the separate governments handled quite inadequately with Dutch and French laws, stalling, as we can see, the continuous progress of the total. referring to the 1648 agreement. There is no form of physical separation, but a concept of oneness shared by two governing entities engaged in jointly ruling over all the economic and natural resources of the island. That is Article 5. Our political leaders have never dealt seriously with this concept in terms of governance that we can say is unique in the world. It was easier, obviously, to allow the European legislation to control each part separately with their already existing laws. The other basic element is the free movement of people, goods, commodities, and money, Article 6. That is Europe before you. Which worked very well about 300 years, as the 1648 agreement was the guidepost of decisions made on the island during that time. But since, French and Dutch laws to regulate each side separately have been implemented, have not been implemented for the common interest of the island and its people. It is obvious that an element of governance is missing in our present constitutional statuses, which is the joint governance of the common situations affecting the daily lives of the people of this island. A lot of work needs to be done by St. Martin government bodies. The present government bodies, governing bodies, have sworn allegiance to the Kingdom of the Netherlands and to the Republic of France, and not to St. Martin. Allow me to add a few remarks concerning joint governance as implied in the 1648 agreement. Both governors were governors of the entire island. We did good. This should be a good recitation for our school children. They didn't say governor of the French side or governor of the Dutch side. And the open border have remained until now, because quite obviously life would be impossible on the 37 square miles with a border. You see yourself reaching to the border, turning back. At this stage of our constitutional development, we need to be creative to solve the problems of the total island and its people. We need to elucidate and interpret the concepts included in the 1648 agreement to suit our present day situation. There is a parliament on the island whose role is to make laws. I do not think we need two. Take advantage of this possibility, which will not be contested by the kingdom, to make and execute laws in the interest of the total island, and also harmonize and any European law to benefit the people of the island. can start with the road network servicing the total island, which symbolizes the blood running through the two Siamese twins. The Parliament of St. Martin is the supreme authority on the island. It is just a matter of political will and vision in respect to the uniqueness of this island. A unique island calls for unique government. However, it will not be done unless the people of St. Martin exert the necessary pressure. They are the ones suffering from this deficit of governance. The Parliament of St. Martin has to take up the task right now, not tomorrow. Coordinating and harmonizing for the benefit of the island and its people. The Parliament of St. Martin has to define the priorities to handle as they become urgent and crucial, for example, transportation control, driving license and work regulations, stricter control of immigration, control of ports, just to name a few. There are many, many others, and I'm going to leave the experts to deal with it. We have to think in matters of the total island of St. Martin. That is the part that is lacking. Our uniqueness, where governance is concerned, is that governance should not be concerned only. That governance should not concern only the French part on one hand and the Dutch part on the other hand, but most essentially, the total island and the free movement of its people and its oneness and uniqueness. We need to seek solutions for the total island and not to expect others to do so for us. This is another Garvey principle. In so doing, that is rethinking the governance of the total island, which many of you in administration, in politics, in everyday life are already doing, we shall attain our true destiny. Exemplified by the observance of the 1648 agreement and revolutionized to suit our contemporary needs as a people. The concept of a three-part governance, Dutch, French, and St. Martin. With the island people represented in a parliament playing a fully dignified role in this unique island in the world. I have presented you with only the framework of the concept. We need to rethink the governance of the total island and make laws in the benefit of its people. I thank you.